Hello. So in this video, we are going to discuss about finding limits using the concept of sequence. Okay. So let's take a quick problem. Suppose we have that limit xn equals to 0. Okay, this is given. Then we want to prove that. Then limit log of 1 plus xn, this is also equals to 0. This we want to prove with the help of the concepts of sequence. Okay, so it is given that limit xn, the sequence xn converges to 0. I want to prove that this sequence, that log of 1 plus xn, this sequence will converge to 0. Now it is very easy to observe that if xn tends to 0, then over here the xn part will tend to 0, then all I'll have is limit 1 in the limit sense, which is going to be 0. But we need to prove this with the help of the concept of sequence, right? Okay, so I want to prove this. That means I want to show that if limit log 1 plus xn, if this is equals to 0, then from the definition of limit, that means I want to show that log mod of log 1 plus xn minus 0 is less than epsilon for some epsilon greater than 0. We will have this thing for all n greater than equals to k, right? So if this is going to be 0, then we must have something like this, right? Then we must have minus epsilon less than log 1 plus xn less than epsilon, right? For all n greater than equals to k. Then if we want to have this statement, suppose I am raising this entire inequality to the power of e. If I raise entire inequality to the power of e, then I'll have e to the power minus epsilon less than, the log part will vanish. So I'll have 1 plus xn less than e to the power epsilon for all n greater than equals to k. Right? Now I am subtracting 1 all over. If I subtract 1, I'll have e to the power minus epsilon minus 1 less than xn less than e to the power epsilon minus 1 for all n greater than equals to k. Right? So if we are able to prove this line, we have limit xn equals to 0. With the help of this, if we are able to prove this line, then I can go one step backwards and backwards and until and unless I reach this point. Okay. So my target is, with the help of this, I want to establish this inequality. The moment I'm able to establish this inequality, then I can definitely prove my theorem. Okay. So these quantities, I need to observe this quantity and this quantity. Okay, so let's start from here. Let's observe these quantities. Epsilon is greater than 0. If epsilon is greater than 0, then e to the power epsilon minus 1, is this quantity positive or negative? This we need to understand. Epsilon is positive, then e to the power something positive is always greater than 1. So this quantity is greater than 1 minus 1. So ultimately we will get something which is greater than 0, right? And similarly, e to the power minus epsilon minus 1, this quantity, e to the power minus epsilon means 1 by e to the power epsilon minus 1, right? Now e to the power epsilon is again greater than 1. So 1 divided by something greater than 1, that means this entire quantity is going to be less than 1, right? So this entire quantity is less than 1 minus 1. So the entire thing is going to be negative. So we'll have less than 0. Right? So if I multiply with a minus sign, I'll have 1 minus e to the power minus epsilon greater than 0. Right? So I have these two things. Now I know the nature of these two quantities. This is positive and this is also positive. Okay. Now I'm going to use the Archimedean principle. Okay, the Archimedean property. The Archimedean property said that, this was basically the extension of the Archimedean property, not the direct property. Using Archimedean property, I can say with the help of this statement, whenever I have some real number, which is the basic approach is, I am considering that this real number is very small. Okay, this real number, if epsilon is very small, then e to the power epsilon is almost very close to 1, but greater than 1. Then this quantity minus 1 is going to be very close to 0, right? So basically my initial thinking is this quantity is very close to 0, but it is positive. Okay, so from Archimedean property I can say that there exists a natural number m1 such that 0 less than 1 by m1 less than this quantity e to the power epsilon minus 1. Right? Using the Archimedean property, the extension of the Archimedean property, I can say this, where m1 is a natural number. Similarly, for this quantity, I can do a similar kind of thing. So again, with the help of this quantity, I can say that there exists a natural number m2 such that 0 less than 1 by m2 less than this quantity is 1 minus e to the power minus epsilon. Right? So using the Archimedean property, we have these two statements. Okay. Now I want both these statements to hold simultaneously for a fixed natural number. Okay, here the natural number is varying. I have one m1, I have one m2. I want both these inequalities to work for a certain fixed natural number. Okay, so what I am doing, I am taking max of m1, m2. Okay, so if I take the maximum of m1 and m2, you can see that if m is maximum of m1 and m2, that means, I am doing this in the rough work, that means m is basically greater than or equals to m1 and m is greater than or equals to m2, right? Since m is max of both of them, so I will have that quantity. Now I am taking the reciprocal, 1 by m is less or equals to 1 by m1 and 1 by m less or equals to 1 by m2, right? So this basically means what? This basically means 1 by m is the minimum of 1 by m1 and 1 by m2, right? Because 1 by m is less or equals to 1 by m1 and 1 by m is again less or equals to 1 by m2, right? And since m was maximum of m1 and m2, so 1 by m is minimum of 1 by m1 and 1 by m2, right? So what I can say is that I am trying to use this m in both the inequalities. So from this inequality, I am going to have that 0 less than 1 by, so if m is greater than or equals to m1, so 1 by m is less or equals to 1 by m1, right? So if I use that over here, 1 by m less or equals to 1 by m1 greater than or equals to 1 by m. So if I try to use it, I will have 1 by m less or equals to 1 by m1 less than e to the power epsilon minus 1, right? Similarly, if I try to use it over here, I'll have 0 less than 1 by m less or equals to 1 by m2 less than 1 minus e to the power minus epsilon using, basically I don't need the minimum condition, basically I'm having it from here. Okay, so now what I'm doing, I'm just omitting the 1 by m1 and 1 by m2, right? So this will basically give me 0 less than 1 by m less than e to the power epsilon minus 1, and this will give me 0 less than 1 by m less than 1 minus e to the power minus epsilon, right? So I have a fixed natural number m for which both the inequalities are now working. Okay, now I have still not used this given fact. Okay, this was given, that limit xn equals to 0, I have still not used that. Now I am going to bring that into the question, because I am erasing off this part. I have these two lines. Now since limit xn equals to 0, from the definition of limit xn equals to 0, I will have mod xn minus 0. Actually, I will have there exists epsilon greater than 0 such that xn minus 0 less than epsilon for all n greater than equals to, let's say, some k. Okay. Now the trick is, I am not going to use this epsilon over here. I want to bring some connection between this and this that I have already done. In order to bring the connection, what I am doing, instead of taking epsilon, I am taking 1 by m. Okay, so I am not writing there exists epsilon greater than 0, because I already have the 1 by m quantity. So 1, and this inequality is they were holding for all n greater than or equals to k, right? Initially they were holding for all n greater than or equals to k. So I'll similarly, I will have this for all n greater than or equals to k, and instead of epsilon, I am using up the 1 by m quantity which is already defined before. Okay, so from here I will have minus 1 by m less than xn less than 1 by m for all n greater than or equals to k. Now somehow I want to bring this into the scenario. What I am doing, in this last inequality that I have got, in this inequality I am multiplying by a minus sign all over. Then if I multiply by a minus sign, I will have e to the power minus epsilon minus 1 less than minus 1 by m less than 0. Okay, so I'm now trying to use up this part over here. Okay, so I have minus 1 by m greater than this quantity, so I'll use that over here. So I'll have e to the power minus epsilon minus 1 less than minus 1 by m, then I have this is less than xn less than 1 by m, and again I can see that 1 by m is less than this quantity, so less than e to the power epsilon minus 1 for all n greater than equals to k. So my these two conditions have been properly used up in this statement. Okay, now what I'm doing, I'm simply ignoring this part and this part, I'm just ignoring them. Then I'll have e to the power minus epsilon minus 1 less than xn less than e to the power epsilon minus 1 for all n greater than equals to k. Now if you remember, this is the line we wanted to get. The moment we get this line, now we can say that this is holding, but I'm showing you how it will happen. I showed this process right at the beginning of this sum. So I'll add 1 all over, then I'll get this quantity, then I'll take log on both sides. So if I take log, I'll have minus epsilon less than log 1 plus xn less than epsilon for all n greater than equals to k. So this basically means mod of log 1 plus xn minus 0 less than epsilon for all n greater than equals to k, and this means limit log 1 plus xn is equals to 0, right? So this was our required proof. So hence the sum is done in this kind of a way. Okay, let us take a look at this question. It is saying that un be a sequence of positive real numbers. Okay, so un is a sequence of positive real numbers such that this limit holds, that is limit un plus 1 by un is equals to l, where l is some real number. Okay, now we have to show that if this l lies between 0 and 1, it can be equal to 0 but it cannot be equal to 1. If it lies between 0 and 1, then the limit un must converge to, then the sequence un must converge to 0. Okay, and if l is greater than 1, then the sequence will converge to, will not converge, it will diverge to infinity. Okay, so let's first try to prove the first part. If you are able to prove the first part, just similarly we can tell about the second part. Okay, it's just going to be the reverse of the first part. Okay, so it's given that un is a sequence of real numbers such that limit un plus 1 by un is equals to l. So from here, what we can say that for epsilon greater than 0, we'll have mod un plus 1 by un minus l less than epsilon for all n greater than equals to k, right? So this was given in the question. Now I am breaking up, breaking this modulus part. I'll have l minus epsilon less than un plus 1 by un less than l plus epsilon for all n greater than equals to k. Okay, now it was for the first part, we are doing the first part. The first part is saying that l lies between 0 and 1 and it is not equal to 1, it is less than 1. That means this epsilon, I'm choosing this epsilon in that kind of way such that when I add epsilon with l, it will not be equal to 1, it will be still less than 1. Okay, so initially l was less than 1, I am adding an epsilon which is so small that even after adding the epsilon with this l, the quantity is still less than 1. Okay, this I need to write at the very beginning, such that l plus epsilon is still less than 1. Okay, this I have considered. When I was choosing the epsilon, I have chosen it in such a way that when I have added epsilon with l, it is still less than 1, right? So that means this quantity is ultimately less than 1. Now let me name the quantity. Let me say that let l plus epsilon is equals to r. Okay, I'm just giving it a name. Then I have considered l plus epsilon less than 1, that means r is less than 1. Okay, so in this part, what I have got, I'm writing in this part, I have got un plus 1 by un is less than r, where r is less than 1, right? Where r is less than 1 for all n greater than equals to k. Okay, let's remember one thing. We had done this in the previous video, that and this quantity l and this quantity is ultimately greater than 0. Why? Because it was said that un is a sequence of positive real numbers. So if it is a sequence of positive real numbers, if I take two consecutive numbers of the sequence and divide them, it is obviously going to be greater than zero. Okay. Now let us recollect one theorem which we had done in the previous video. The theorem was, if 0 less than r less than 1, then limit r to the power n is equals to 0. Right? We had done this theorem before. If r is a real number which lies between 0 and 1, then limit r to the power n will converge to 0. Right? So here r is that kind of a number which lies between 0 and 1. Right? So r lies between 0 and 1, then I have this thing in our hand. Okay, so I'm calling this as number 1. Right? So I have that 1 in our hand. Now what I'm doing, this inequality will hold whenever n is greater than or equals to k. Okay, so I am using this part of the inequality and I'm putting k, then k plus 1 and so on, one by one I'm putting. So if I put k over here, I'll have uk plus 1 by uk less than r, right? Similarly, if I put k plus 1, I'll have uk plus 1 by u, sorry, I'll have uk plus 2 by uk plus 1 less than r. Okay, similarly, if I keep on putting this, I'm going up till uk plus n minus k divided by uk plus n minus, it's all in the suffix, n minus k minus 1. Okay, so basically I have gone up till k plus 1 plus 2 up till n minus k, and similarly in the denominator it will be 1 less, so n minus k minus 1, which is similarly going to be less than r, and this will hold for all n greater than equals to not k. Keep in mind, see here the last term that I have written, this is basically if the k gets cancelled out, the last term, I'm just writing the last term, this last term is basically, if the k gets cancelled out, I have un by, if the again the k gets cancelled out, un minus 1. Okay. So if I put k over here, if I put n equals to k over here, then I will have uk by uk minus 1. But it was not holding for that k, right? It was not holding for k minus 1. This inequality started holding for all n greater than or equals to k. And when I put the k, the first term was this. The first term was not this. Okay. This is the term which comes before this term. So I don't know if this is going to be less than r or not. So since there is a problem in the suffix, we are getting a problem in the suffix, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to take for all n greater than or equals to k plus 1, right? Because if I put k plus 1 in place of n now, then I will have uk plus 1 by uk, which is basically just the first term. So that is the way of writing the general term over here. Okay. So now what I'm doing, I am multiplying all these terms. Okay, I'm simply multiplying all these terms. If I multiply these terms one by one, you can see that uk plus 1 is going to get cancelled with this uk, right? If I multiply them, it's going to get cancelled with this uk. Then this uk plus 2 is going to get cancelled with the next term over here. And similarly, ultimately this term is going to get cancelled out. So if I multiply all these, what I will have is this term over here and this term over here. So I'll have u, and what is this term? This term is basically, if the k gets cancelled out, I have un divided by, this term is uk less than, how many term inequalities were here? We have to understand that, how many inequalities were here? Just follow this suffix over here, just follow the index, 1, 2, and we went up till n minus k. So how many inequalities are here? N minus k number of inequalities. So that many number of times I'm multiplying this r, so I'll have r to the power n minus k. For all n greater than equals to k plus 1. Okay. So I'm just cross multiplying un less than uk into r to the power n minus k. I'm breaking it as r to the power n divided by r to the power k. Okay. And I'm keeping this term in a bracket. For all n greater than equals to k plus 1. Now remember one thing which I had just now deduced and called it equation number 1. What was equation number 1? Limit r to the power n equals to 0. I had called this equation number 1 because r was lying between 0 and 1. So here what can I say? In the limiting sense, this r to the power n is going to tend to 0, right? So taking limit, what are we going to get? Taking limit n tending to infinity. If I take limit n tending to infinity on both sides, I'm going to get limit un. Here r to the power n is becoming how much? R to the power n is becoming 0 in the limiting sense. So I cannot write that this thing is less than 0. Why cannot I write less than 0? Because all the terms of un were positive real numbers, right? So in the limiting sense, it is going to become equal to 0, right? Because if all the terms in a sequence are positive, then how can the limit convert to something negative? It is not possible. So less than r to the power n means in the limiting sense, it is going to become equal to 0, right? So this was the proof of the theorem. So similarly, in the second part, where l, here in this part, l was lying between 0 less or equals to l less than 1. For the second part, l is greater than 1. So in that case, how do we start? I'm just telling you how we will start, and then you can do it on your own. In this part, we had started off in this way, that l plus epsilon is less than 1, right? In this part, we'll start in this way, that l minus epsilon is still greater than 1. Okay, we'll just start from here and then proceed exactly similarly, and we can conclude that limit un will be equal to infinity. Okay, now let's take a look at another sum. It is saying that the sequence un is defined by, how it is defined, un plus 2 equals to un plus 1 plus un by 2. That means a term in the sequence is defined by, let's say this is the third term, the third term is defined by the average of first term and second term, right? So nth term is defined by the average of the two previous terms. Okay, so this is how the sequence is defined for all n greater than equals to 1, and it is said that this is how the first two terms are defined, that the first, the u2, it is greater than u1, and both of them are greater than 0. Okay, so the first two terms are positive, and so with the help of these first two terms, now I can create the third term and so on. Now I need to prove that the limit un, this value of limit un is going to be this. That means the sequence un will converge to this value. Okay, so this thing is given to us. Let's take the help of this. From here I can say that u2 minus u1 is going to be greater than 0, right? So this quantity is greater than 0. Okay, now let me take a look at the next quantities that I'm going to have. Now let me see what will be the value of, let's say, u3 minus u2. Okay, now I'm going to examine the value of this quantity. So I'm finding the value of u3 from this relation. U3 is going to be, if I put n equals to 1, I will have u2 plus u1, right? So I'll have u2 plus u1 by 2. So this is the value of u3 minus u2. So if I do some calculations over here, I'll have u1 by 2 minus u2 by 2. So if I take minus half common, I'll have u2 minus u1, right? Okay, so now I'm going to the next part. So next part is going to be u4 minus u3. Okay, so now I'm putting the value of u4. So u4 is going to be u3 plus u2, average of the previous two terms, minus u3. Okay, so if I simplify this, I'm going to get u2 by 2 minus u3 by 2. Now again, I can put the value of u3. The value of u3 was this quantity. So if I take half common over here, I'll have u2 minus, the value of u3 is, this is the value of u3, u2 plus u1 by 2. Right, so if I do the LCM in this part, so I'll have minus half square. If I take minus common, then I'm going to have make this 1 by 4, then I'll have 2u2 minus u2, that is going to be u2, and I'll have minus u1. Right, so basically I can write this as minus half whole square u2 minus u1, right? So I've got the value of u4 minus u3. So let me sum up the values that I'm getting. First, I have got, firstly I can write that u2 minus u1 is basically equals to u2 minus u1. I'm not doing any manipulation over here. Then coming to the next step, I've got u3 minus u2 is equals to this quantity, which is minus half u2 minus u1, right? Next, I'm coming to the quantity u4 minus u3, u4 minus u3, I have got how much? This is the value. So minus half square u2 minus u1, right? So if I proceed similarly, this calculation goes on, then let's say when I reach un minus 1, what is the value that I'm going to get? Observe over here, when the suffix is 2, when this index of u is 2, we have minus half to the power 1, right? When the suffix is 3, I have minus half to the power 2. So basically there is a difference of 1. So when the suffix is n minus 1, I'll have minus half to the power. If I reduce one more term over here, I'll have n minus 2, right? And over here I have u2 minus u1, okay? Now what I'm doing, I am adding up all these terms. Okay, I'm adding up all these terms. So total, how many equations are here? If this is equation number 1, this is equation number 2, this is equation number 3, then this is equation number how much? 1, 2, 3, n minus 1. So this is equation number n minus 1. Okay. Now we can see that if I add all these terms, this u2 and u2 are going to get cancelled out. u3 going to get cancelled out. In the next step, u4 is going to get cancelled out. And ultimately, un minus 1 will also get cancelled out. So I will have un minus u1. So these are the two terms that are going to remain. So I'll have un minus u1. And on the right hand side, if I take u2 minus u1 common, then from the first equation, if I take u2 minus u1 common, I will have 1, right? Then coming to the second equation, I'll have minus half. Then third equation, I'll have minus half whole square, and so on up till minus half to the power n minus 2, right? So this is the third, in the third bracket, the terms that I've got, you can notice that they are in, this is a GP series, right? And what is the common ratio? The common ratio is minus half. If I multiply by minus half, I'll get this GP series, okay? So now I'm trying to find out the value of this GP series. Up to n terms, what was the formula for finding sum of GP series? This was the formula, A into 1 minus R to the power n by 1 minus R. We used to take this formula when R was less than 1. Here, what is the value of R? The common ratio is minus half, which is less than 1. So this formula is applicable, right? So I'm applying the formula. I'll have u2 minus u1. Okay, now one more thing. How many terms are here? Total, how many terms are here? Here I can write minus half to the power 1. So there are these half terms, there are n minus 2 number of terms like this, and another term which is simply 1. So how many terms are there? There are total n minus 1 number of terms, right? So over here the formula is going to be 1 minus r to the power n minus 1, because there are n minus 1 terms. I am finding the sum of n minus 1 terms, okay? So my a is how much? My a is 1. So I am not writing the a part because my a is 1. I will have 1 minus r to the power n minus 1. What is my r? My r is minus half to the power n minus 1 divided by 1 minus r. 1 minus r is going to be 1 minus of minus half, right? This is going to be my r value. So now I'm just simplifying that part. If I simplify this part, I will have un minus u1 is equals to u2 minus u1. In the numerator part, I have 1 minus half to the power n minus 1, and the denominator is going to be 3/2. So I can write over here by 3, and I can bring the 2 over here because I am going to get 3/2. Okay, now I am taking, okay, let me bring this 3 also outside. Now suppose I'm taking limit on both sides. Okay, so if I take limit on both sides, limit un minus u1 on the right hand side, this entire term is a constant term. So 2/3 u2 minus u1 limit 1 minus half to the power n minus 1. So now the question is, what will be the value of this limit over here? Now again, remember the theorem which we have done before. If modulus of r is less than 1, then limit r to the power n will be equal to 0, right? Here I can consider this as my r, right? This thing is basically r to the power n minus 1, right? If limit r to the power n is 0, then obviously limit r to the power n minus 1 is also 0. and here I can say what is my r. My r value is minus half, whose modulus is less than 1. So if I take limit of minus half to the power n minus 1, what I'm going to get? I'm going to get 0, right? So I'm using that in the next step. Over here u1 is a constant, so limit un, and u1 will simply come outside equals to 2 by 3 u2 minus u1. Limit of 1 is going to be 1 minus limit of this term is going to be 0, right? So just if I take this u1 on that side and do a little LCM, then I'm going to get u 2 by 3 u2 minus u1 plus u1, right? So if I do the LCM, I get 2u2 minus 2u1 plus 3u1 by 3. So this is going to be u1 plus 2u2 by 3, which was my required proof over here, right? So hence this sum is done. Now let's take a look at another sum. This is saying that the sequence un is defined by that the first term of the sequence is root over 2, and the next term is basically root over of 2 into the previous term. Okay, this is how the sequence is defined for n greater than or equals to 1. Then I need to prove that limit un, that means the sequence un is converging to 2. Okay, so the first term is given, and how the sequence is in general behaving, that is given. Okay, so it is given that u1 equals to root 2. Now I'm trying to find out u2. How to find out u2? If I put n equals to 1 over here, I'll have u2 equals to root over of 2 u1, right? Sorry. Now the value of u1 is root 2. So I'll have root over of 2 into root 2, right? Now I'm just simplifying this part. So this is basically 2 root 2 whole to the power half, right? Now again I can write 2, this root 2 I can write as 2 to the power half whole to the power half, right? Now 2 into 2 to the power half, that is going to be 2 to the power 1 plus half, right? Whole to the power half, because here I have 2 to the power 1 into 2 to the power half, so that is going to be 2 to the power 1 plus half and whole to the power half. Now multiplying this half, I'll get 2 to the power half plus half square, right? Now a very important manipulation, you can take a look at this. I have half plus half square. What I'm doing, I'm adding one more half square and I'm subtracting half square. Okay, so I've managed the terms. Now addition of these two terms, this is basically 1 by 4 1 by 4, so addition of these two terms is going to give me simply half, right? Addition of these two is going to be half. Now half plus half is again going to be how much? 1. So I'll have 1 minus half square, right? So this term is coming down to 1 minus half square. So I'm writing this as 2 to the power 1 minus half square. Okay. Similarly, now I'm going for the next part. For the next calculation, I'm taking u3. U3 is going to be root over of 2 u2, right? Now u2, what is the value of u2? This is the value of u2. I am using this value, okay, not the final one. I'm using this value of u2. So I'll have root over of 2 into the value of u2. I'm using this value, 2 to the power half plus half square, right? So if I multiply these two terms, basically 1 will be added. So I'll have root over of 2 to the power 1 plus half square, right? Because I have here 2 to the power 1 into this thing, right? Now there is a total root over. So I remove this root over, I'll have 2 to the power 1 plus half square whole to the power half, right? Okay, so now if I multiply that half inside, I'll have 2 to the power half plus half square plus 2q. Now I'll do a simple similar manipulation just like this one. You can note that, okay, I'm erasing off this part. We need to prove limit un is equal to 2. I'm not erasing that. Now I'm just managing this part. Let's say I have half plus half square plus 2 to the power 3. I'm adding one more 2 to the power 3, just like the previous case, and subtracting 2 to the power 3. Now if you note, addition of these two, this is basically 1 by 8 and 1 by 8. So addition of 1 by 8 and 1 by 8 is going to give me 1 by 4. That means 1 by 2 square. Right? So this is going to come down to half plus half square plus half square minus 1 by 2 cube. Again, addition of these two terms is going to give me simply half, right? Addition of these two is going to be half. Then again, half plus this half is going to be 1. So ultimately, I will have 1 minus 1 by 2 cube, just like this calculation. Okay? So this is going to come down to 2 to the power 1 minus 1 by 2 cube. Okay? So I'm just summarizing whatever I have got up till now. I have got the value of u1 as root 2. Root 2 means basically 2 to the power half. Then I have got the value of u2 as this. I'm just writing that value over here. I have got u2 equals to 2 to the power 1 minus half square. Okay. Then I have got the value of u3. u3 value is this. So I'm writing the value of u3 over here. u3 I have got 2 to the power 1 minus 1 by 2 cube. So now you can understand that there is a proper sequence. So what will be the nth term of this sequence? The nth term will be 2 to the power 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power n. Right, so we have got the nth term of the sequence. So therefore, this is how the sequence is looking like. Now I need to find out limit un. Okay, so I'm taking limit on both sides. In this line, I'm taking limit on both sides. Limit un, I will have limit 2 to the power 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power n. Right, I've just substituted the value. Okay, so if I break this up, I will have, okay, now let me call this entire power, let me call this power as xn sequence. Okay, I'm calling it an xn sequence. So basically I have limit 2 to the power xn, if I call this as the xn sequence, where xn sequence is 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power n. Okay, so now I need to find limit of this xn sequence. Okay, so limit xn is going to be how much? Limit 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power n, that is going to be 1 minus limit 1 by 2 to the power n. Now what will be the value of this sequence, this limit? The value of this limit is going to be 0. We already know because of this, from this theorem, that if modulus of r is less than 1, the limit r to the power n is equals to 0. Here what is my r? My r is half. So modulus of half is less than 1, so its limit is going to be 0. So over here I'll have simply 1. So limit xn is simply 1. Okay. So what will be the value of this limit un? So I have limit xn equals to 1. Now I can apply this theorem. Suppose I have, let's say, let limit xn equals to L and a is greater than 0, then limit a to the power xn, that is going to be how much? A to the power L. Right, this was one theorem. If limit xn is L and if a is greater than 0, then limit a to the power xn is going to be a to the power L. So I can apply that theorem over here. What is my a? My a is 2. Right, this 2 is basically my a. I'm again writing it properly. I have limit un equals to, limit un equals to this thing, limit 2 to the power xn. Right, and my limit xn is how much? Limit xn, I have found out, limit xn is 1, right? So my L is basically 1, a greater than 0, where a is basically 2. So this entire thing is satisfying this theorem. So applying this theorem, what am I going to get? I'm going to get limit un equals to 2 to the power 1, right? Which is equals to 2, which was my required proof. Okay, so these are some sums which are related to finding limit where the sequence is already defined.